Hello friends, I am Suvarna Gaikwad, working as assistant professor in Department of Botany of Dada Patil Mahavidyalaya Karjat, District Ahmednagar. First of all, I welcome you all in the TYBSC paper 2, that is Cell and Molecular Biology. So friends, as we are dealing with the cell biology, in previous sessions, we have seen the cell biology and its associated branches, different units of measurement of cell, then types of cells such as prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. And today, we are going to discuss the new topic, that is plant cell nucleus. So let's start. So in today's session, we will going to see the introduction of nucleus, its morphology, then ultrastructure of nucleus and functions of nucleus. So let's study one by one. So nucleus, it is a membrane bound organelle that contains genetic material of organisms. As we know, most of the organisms, they contain DNA as genetic material. So nucleus is a membrane bound organelle that contains DNA of organisms. Coming to the discovery, the nucleus was discovered by scientist Robert Brown in 1831 in orchid cells. As we know, the word carrion, it is described as nucleus. So the study of nucleus is called as karyology, okay, as the nucleus was derived from word carrion, okay. These nucleus controls all activities of the cell, and the important aspect is it maintains the integrity of the cell by promoting the important processes like transcription and DNA replication. Okay, so coming to the position of the nucleus. So this is a eukaryotic cell structure. In that, we are able to see the central place it was given by the nucleus. So this is a nucleus. So nucleus is situated in the center of cell, and it was surrounded by cytoplasm from all sides. Okay, then we will discuss the morphology of nucleus. For the morphology, we will consider the number of nucleus, then shape of nucleus, and finally size of nucleus. Let's study one by one. First is the number of nucleus. So according to number of nucleus, cells are classified as mononucleated cells, then binucleated cells, and polynucleated cells. Mononucleated cells are the cells which contain single nucleus. Okay, now most of the plants and animals, they contain single nucleus, so they are mononucleated cells. The second type of cell, it is a binucleated cells. Okay, as the name suggests, the cells which contains two nuclei, they are called as binucleated cells. And the well-known example of binucleated cells is paramecium. Okay, so this is a photograph of binucleated cells. Okay, and the third type of cell, is a polynucleated cells. As the name suggests, poly means many. So the cells which contain many nuclei, they may be ranging from 3 to 100 nuclei. So when these polynucleated cells present in animals, they are particularly called as syncytial cells. Okay, and the example of syncytial cells is osteoblast. Osteoblast are the polynucleated cells which are present in the bone marrow. Okay, and when these polynucleated cells, they are present in plants, at that time they are called as cnosites. As we know, there are many algae and fungi. If we take example of fungi, the mycelium of fungi, they are cnositic in nature. The word cnosite means multinucleated condition. Okay, in this way, when polynucleated cells present in animals called as syncytial cells, and when polynucleated cells present in plants called as cnosites. Okay, so these are polynucleated cells. Then we will discuss the shape of nucleus. Now the shape of nucleus is related with the shape of cell. But there are certain nuclei which are irregular in shape. For example, the spheroid, cuboid or the polyhedral cells, they contain spheroid nuclei. Then cylindrical cells, they contain ellipsoidal nuclei. Then the cells of squamous epithelium, they contain discoidal nuclei. And the well-known example is of leukocytes. Okay, leukocytes, also the glandular cells of the insects and spermatozoa, they contain irregular shaped nuclei. For example, this is a figure of muscle fibers. In these muscle fibers, these are darkly stained, these are the nuclei, and they are elongated in shape. Whereas this second figure is of white blood cells, that is leukocytes. In this figure, we are able to see there are various types of WBCs, such as neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, monocytes and the lymphocytes, and they are irregular in shape. So the shape of nuclei depends on shape of the cell, whereas certain nuclei, they are irregular in shape. Coming to the size of nucleus, so generally nucleus occupies the 10% of the total cell volume, and nuclei, they vary from 3 micron to 25 micron in diameter. Then scientist Hartwig has given the formula for calculating the size of nucleus of a particular cell. So for calculating the size of nucleus, the formula is Np is equal to Vn divided by Vc minus Vn. Whereas Np, it is the nucleoprotein index. Vn is the volume of nucleus, and Vc is the volume of the cell. Okay, that means nucleoprotein index is equal to volume of nucleus divided by volume of cell minus volume of nucleus. Okay, so this is the formula for calculating the size of nucleus. Also, the size of nucleus is related with the number of chromosomes. The haploid cells, they contain small sized nuclei as compared to diploid cells. Okay, similarly, the polyploid cells, they contain larger nuclei than diploid cells. So, the concluding remark is the size of nucleus of a cell depends on volume of cell, amount of DNA and protein, and metabolic phase of the cell. So, this is all about the size of nucleus. So, in this way, we have seen the morphology of nucleus. In that, the size, shape, and number have seen. Okay, now we are moving towards the ultrastructure of a nucleus. So, a nucleus shows main four components such as nuclear membrane, nucleoplasm, then chromatin fibers, and finally the nucleolus. So, this is the figure for ultrastructure of nucleus. The main four components are, this is the outermost covering or the envelope, which is called as nuclear membrane, which is followed by, this is the matrix inside called as nucleoplasm. Then these are the chromatin fibers or the chromatin material, and this is the nucleolus. Okay, let's study one by one. The first important component is nuclear membrane. So, in this figure we are able to see, this is the nuclear membrane. The nuclear membrane is also called as nuclear envelope. Actually, it is made up of two membranes. Okay, so the outer membrane is adjacent to cytoplasm and the inner membrane is adjacent to nucleoplasm. Sometimes the outer membrane, they contains ribosome attached to it. Okay, so it is connected with the endoplasmic reticulum. As we know that it is rough endoplasmic reticulum. Then the space present between these two membranes is called as perinuclear space. The nuclear membrane of most of the eukaryotes, it is perforated by pores. That pores are called as nuclear pores. Okay, and the function of nuclear membrane is, it separates the genetic material of the cell from the cytoplasm. Also, it acts as a barrier to prevent passage of macromolecules between nucleoplasm and cytoplasm. Okay, so this is the nuclear membrane. The second important component is nucleoplasm. So, the space present between nuclear membrane and nucleolus is filled by transparent semi-solid substance, and that substance is called as nucleoplasm. Okay, in the nucleoplasm, the chromatin material and the nucleolus, they remain suspended. Now, the nucleoplasm has a very complex chemical composition, as it is composed of mainly nucleoproteins. Along with that, it also contains other inorganic and organic substances like lipids, enzymes, and minerals. Okay, the next component is chromatin fibers. So, the nucleoplasm contains many thread-like, coiled, and elongated structures. These elongated structures or thread-like structures are called as chromatin fibers. The chromatin fibers are twisted and they are uniformly distributed in the nucleoplasm. Such chromatin fibers, these are observed only in the interface of the cell division. Okay, now in the interphasic nucleus, these chromatin fibers are thread-like, okay, and long, but during the process of cell divisions, as the cell division processes or progresses, there is a condensation of this chromatin material takes place. There is a shortening and thickening of chromatin material, and finally the chromatin material are converted into thick ribbon like structures. Now they are developed into well known chromosomes. Okay, chemically these chromatin consist of DNA and proteins, and the most of the protein is histone, but non-histone proteins are also present. Now these chromatin material, it is of two types. First is the heterochromatin and second is the euchromatin. Okay, now in this figure we are able to differentiate the two types of chromatin. This is a loosely arranged structure, which is euchromatin, and this is a compactly arranged chromatin, which is heterochromatin. So heterochromatin, it is a darkly stained and condensed region of chromatin. It contains comparatively small amount of DNA, and it is metabolically and genetically inert in nature. Whereas the second type of chromatin is euchromatin. It is loosely arranged and lightly stained. Okay, but it contains comparatively large amount of DNA. Okay, finally the component of nucleus is nucleolus. Okay, now nucleus contains a large darkly stained and spherical structure. That structure is called as nucleolus. The size of nucleus depends on synthetic activity of any cell. For example, if the cell with little or no synthetic activity, for example the muscle cells, they contain smaller or no nucleoli. Whereas the cells such as oocytes or the neurons, they synthesize proteins, so they contains large sized nucleoli. So in this way, size of nucleolus depends on synthetic activity of the cell. Then number of nucleoli, they may be 1, 2 or 4. Now the position of nucleolus in the nucleus is eccentric, means it is present either at one side of the nucleus. It is not present in the center. The nucleolus contains soluble materials of the nucleolus. Okay, soluble materials like enzymatic proteins, RNA, ribonucleoproteins, ions, and most important, precursors of nucleosides and nucleotides. Okay, coming to the function of nucleolus, so it assembles ribosomal subunits in eukaryotic cells. Okay, so these are some aspects of nucleolus. Now coming to the functions of nucleolus. So most important function of nucleus is it controls the heredity of an organism. Also, it maintains cellular metabolism by controlling synthesis of particular enzymes. Okay? Similarly, it is responsible for most important processes like growth, cell division, differentiation, and protein synthesis. It stores the genetic material in the form of DNA. It also stores proteins and RNA. Okay? And it is a site for transcription process. As we know that Transcription is the process in which there is a conversion of DNA to RNA. Okay? Then, nucleus also helps in exchange of DNA and RNA between nucleus and rest of the cells. Nucleolus produces ribosomes, and as we know that ribosomes are the protein factories. Okay? And the important function is it regulates the integrity of the genes and the gene expression. So these are certain functions of nucleus. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. In that we have seen the morphology of nucleus, then ultrastructure, functions of nucleus. So these are certain references for this topic. So friends, we will stop here and we'll meet in the next session with the new topic. Thank you very much.